Howdy, howdy, friends and anglers. Dan Rice here, signing in from the River Feet Fly Tying Saloon. Thank you for joining us again today. We're going to be tying up one of my custom patterns called the Cicada Bomber. Now, this pattern is based very closely on Kent Edmonds' famous pattern, the Stealth Bomber. His pattern's been a staple in my bass box for more than a decade. Love that thing. It's caught tons of fish. It was only within the last couple of years that I decided I want to tweak that pattern and turn it into something that more resembled the profile of cicadas. Now, if you're a fly angler living in cicada country, you've probably heard by now the rumors that 2024 is going to be a banner year for the cicadas. Those rumors are true. So let's talk about that a little bit. The cicadas that emerge annually, the perennial ones, are those black, green, little bit of white ones. The ones that are emerging this year are going to be black and orange. You'll also see the black and green ones, the normal ones. The black and orange ones, this is the really cool thing that's happening. And something is happening this year that hasn't happened in 221 years. And that is an emergence of the Brood XII and also simultaneously emergence of the Brood XIX, Roman numeral 19, right? They're going to be emerging throughout the southeast region. And that can happen as early as late April, all the way through about late May. Typically, they start to emerge once that soil temperature is consistently in about a 50 to 55 degree temperature. So just a brief intro into cicada life cycle 101. All right, so we'll start with, where should we start, the chicken or the egg? Let's start with the chicken. Let's start with the female cicada, the adult. At the end of her season, she is finding a tree, preferably a newly sprouted smaller tree branch, where she actually can carve slices into these little tree branches. She deposits her eggs. The eggs will incubate in that tree until they're ready to hatch and emerge as nymphs. And then at their first molting, they crawl out of that tree as nymphs. They crawl down to the soil. They're subterranean insects. They're not aquatic insects, so they're in the terrestrial family. So those nymphs come out of the tree, they crawl down, they burrow into the soil, and then they live in that soil, molting and growing for whatever their life cycle is. So the perennials, they're a one-year life cycle, so they're molting faster in between each one and coming out and emerging the following year. All the species go through five moltings, just at different rates. So, for example, our Brood XIX that we're looking forward to fishing with here in Southwest Virginia, from the time that egg is laid in a tree, that nymph hatches from the tree, crawls into the soil, burrows down, lives underneath that soil, subterranean. Those nymphs climb up out of the soil and they return to a nearby tree looking for large leaves, other foliage that they can climb out on. And then, similar to like your stoneflies and your dragonflies, they shed their final nymphal skin. They crawl out of that, a little bit like a butterfly coming out of its chrysalis, and they emerge as the flying, buzzing insects. It's only the males that sing. They use these, they have this special appendages on their abdomen that create those songs, that loud, vibrating, trilling sound. They'll live as adults for typically about 30 days. And as adults, they don't eat at all. They have consumed enough energy through their nymphal stage, that life cycle, that subterranean life cycle. They have consumed enough energy to survive as adults without eating. So what that means is, during that first 30 days of this cicada life cycle, the fish are used to seeing some of them on the water. There's not a whole lot of them that are hitting that water. Doesn't mean you won't still catch them on cicada patterns during that first 30 days of emergence. But when that bonanza really begins is after their mating cycle has finished and those males start to die off right away. Now, they're basically just falling right out of the air as they die. They're just plummeting, boom. And so That means they're landing on the water, they're landing on your yard, they're landing on the hood of your car. And then those females return to the tree, slice open a slit where they lay their eggs, and then they'll often fall as well, dead. And sometimes that tree branch where they laid their eggs just happens to be right over the water. So they'll fall off that overhanging branch into the water. So when we're fishing these things, I like to cast them with a bit of a plop. And the way we get strikes with these things will typically happen in one of two ways. Now, if you get a good cast, looking for casting around structure, casting under overhanging branches, lots of times, the way this will happen, if that fly splats on the water within a 5-foot radius of a fish, you're gonna get a hit almost instantly. So be ready as soon as that thing hits the water, bam. If that hit doesn't happen instantly, we will oftentimes see these soft sipped on the dead drift. So you cast, you let it splat, you're ready for that strike, you're ready for that hit. If that doesn't happen pretty quickly, you're mending your line, you're keeping it just dead drifted. Give it an occasional, just a super slight twitch, just enough to kind of make those legs wiggle a little bit. That sends some vibrations through the water. Fish are hypersensitive to responding to those vibrations. That's how they hear sound. And then the other way that it happens is that things drifting down. In that scenario, the fish are seeing it. They're looking up. They'll oftentimes nose it. If they're happy with the way it looks, bam, take it in, set the hook. We'll also include an illustration for dimensions of that piece of foam you're going to need to cut out. I use these Kona Streamer 4XL size 2 hook. That gives me the right hook shank length, which is we'll call about 1.25 inches plus almost 1/2 inch hook gap. Lock your hook in place. I'm going to use some orange flat wax thread. You want to go minimum of 140 denier. You can go up to a 210. You want to go pretty fat with this stuff. I'm going to start our thread. And we're going to bring it back to where it's parallel with the barb on that hook. Now with your black foam, you're going to use this cutout I provided that shows the dimensions, and you're going to create a mold. And so you're going to trace that out, you're going to cut that sheet of paper out, and you're going to hold that over your foam, you're going to trace it onto your foam, and you're going to cut out your strip of foam. So go ahead and pause the video until you get there. And what I would recommend right off the bat is using that first piece of foam you cut, and using that to trace and cut another one, just because it's easier to trace this foam than it is a piece of paper. And then set that one aside and save that for future ones. So to get started here, you have your taper from the back of your bug down to your straight section. We're gonna go about 1/4 inch from where that taper ends and the straight section begins. And I'm gonna fold it straight back, so it looks like that. And we're gonna lay that so the front bend is just barely over that hook eye. And I'm gonna flip that up and hold it to this hook shank on the top and kind of form that foam around the hook shank. Give it 2 loose wraps, 1, 2, right in line with that hook barb. Pull it snug. Lift those foam pieces up on both ends, wrap 2 in the front, 1 around the back, bring 1 back over, bring that thread to the front. Now I like this hairline cactus chenille in hot orange, and I'm using the medium size. And if you have a rotary vise, you don't need to cut a strip, just roll off your existing chunk of chenille. If you don't have a rotary vise, cut yourself a 4-inch long strip. I'm gonna peel off just the tips, peel off the material from just the very tip of that chenille to expose the core, tie that core in place right where that foam begins. And then loose wrap your thread all the way to the throat of the hook. Now if you're using a rotary vise, give yourself a little half hitch right there. Cradle that bobbin. Then we're gonna take our chenille and loose wrap it all the way up. They don't have to be real tight wraps. We aren't looking to build bulk. We just wanna cover that hook shank with that bright flashy orange color. If you don't have orange, use white, would be my next choice. And bring that chenille up to just a little ways behind the throat of the hook. And then we're gonna tie that off. Snip it. Okay, next step. You're gonna take this, what looks like a tail in the piece of foam, and we're gonna roll that up. When you do that, you don't want it pulled tight, you wanna roll it up so it creates kind of a bow. So it makes the bug look fatter. One cool thing about this pattern, you don't have to stack a whole bunch of foam pieces together to get that thick body. You can use this one strip and fold it so that it creates kind of an artificial bulk look. And you're gonna fold it, and it should go at least a little bit past the middle of the hook shank. And I'm gonna mark with my finger where that went. Then I'm gonna loosen up this thread, and I'm gonna do some loose wraps through that cactus chenille back to where my finger marked the spot. Now we're gonna take our foam and this first part of it, the part facing front with the full body. We're gonna pinch it tight, do two loose wraps over, one, two, pull it tight, and then take your tail piece of foam, fold it up. You should have that little angle piece cut off of there. So it looks like that. That makes it a little easier to tie into place. And we're gonna hold that angled piece right to where it's just barely in front of the hook thread, and just give that thread two wraps over that. Bam. Okay. Now for the wings, I like this Microlon stuff. It's got a good little bit of flashiness to it. It's easy to work with. It's rigid enough to where the wings stay straight out the back and sides like that. If you don't have this exact material, you can use just about any synthetic strand material. Or you can even use like a flashaboo or a crystal flash. The original Stealth Bomber used bucktail. You can use bucktail. I find that stuff a little less friendly to work with in this application, but it'll fish just fine. So if you are not using this exact material, just wait until you see how it looks when it's finished before you continue. If you don't have orange, next best option would be white. And I'm just gonna, with this Microlon, I'm just gonna twist that full strand together. It's about 6 inches long. I'm gonna fold it in half, match up the two tag ends. Snip that loop. And I'm gonna take it and I'm gonna fold it in, marry them together, just twist them, marry them together. I'm gonna fold it in half again, lining up those tag ends. Marry them together. So it'll look like that right now. I'm gonna trim off any that are longer than the rest. I'm gonna trim down to the shortest one, and holding it like so, a few stragglers, that's okay. I'm gonna hold that portion right on top here, and I'm going to do two loose wraps into place, keeping that centered on the top. One, two. Release. Stretch out a few inches of thread. I'm going to take my brush-on glue. I'm going to cover about an inch of that thread with some brush on glue. And this is gonna help tie, or bond rather, the ends that we tied in. It's gonna bond those all together so that if you're digging this out of a fish's mouth, you got those hemostats in there, you don't wanna rip off your wings. This will help hold them in place better. So I'm just gonna cover that until I've covered that glue. Loose wraps, you don't want too tight of wraps on here. Okay. Next step, I'm gonna snip off this loop in the wings. So now if you're using a different material, you can see about how thick that should look on your fly. And for length, I'm now going to pull these all together as one, pinch them at the very end, and I'm gonna trim it to where there's about a half inch extending beyond the back of that tail. And I'm gonna kind of spread these a little bit. Okay, so we got our wings in place. Now we're gonna go with our legs. For our legs, I use these 5-inch long silicone skirting material. What you're gonna need, you're gonna want 4 legs sticking out of each side of the body, and each leg is gonna be between an inch and a half long. These pieces work great because I can just cut 2 strips, 1 for each side, fold it in half, like so, pinch it in the middle, loop facing front of the hook. And now when you tie this in right on the side, if you get the legs tied in that space between the 2 layers of foam, what will happen there is then when you pull it, it will seal it right in to that little gap rather than just sitting out on the edge of the fly. So do that same thing on each side. Bam. So they're flared out a little bit like butterfly wings right now. I'm gonna give it one more loose wrap over top, and then I'm gonna pull everything back. I'm gonna get that foam, one wrap of thread right in front of that foam. Then I'm gonna loose wrap up until, we'll call it almost 1/4 inch behind the throat of the hook eye. Our next step, take a little really skinny strip of preferably red foam. If you don't have red foam, orange or white or green are your next best choices. Just a really skinny strip, about 1/2 inch to 3/4 inch long. We're gonna cut most of it off. So it doesn't have to be any longer than 1/2 inch. We're gonna place that inside that foam on the top of this inner layer, right in line with the back of the hook eye, and then fold that foam up over it. Pull those eyes, that piece, a little strip of foam is gonna be the eyes, and pull that up nice and tight. And then with that back of the bug centered over the hook, we're gonna take our thread, try and aim it at the camera here so you can see it better. Take our thread and do 1, 2, 3 very loose wraps. You don't want tight wraps here. We don't want to create a skinny neck on this fly. So once you got those 3 loose wraps, stretch out some thread again. Take your brush on glue. This time we're going to cover 1.5 to 2 inches of thread with that. And we're gonna wrap this over that foam. So this will help hold that in place since we aren't doing really tight wraps. We want this to just kind of bond everything together, prevent it from twisting, shifting around as much. There we go. Throw a few extra wraps on there. Okay. Now, find yourself a piece of orange foam, preferably. If you don't have orange foam, match the color of whatever color you used on your eyes. And you're gonna cut a strip That's about a quarter inch wide by about a half inch long to look like what's on the top of here. So I'm just taking and trimming a 45 degree angle slightly off the front, and then a sharp angle off the back. So it's got a long pointy on the back and just a little bit of a bevel on that front. And then we're gonna take a glue of your choice. I got this gel glue. I'm gonna put a little drop centered on that thread. And then we're gonna take our little piece of orange foam, put that right over that glue drop so we can tie it in, and then do loose wraps again. One, two, three, so it looks like so. I'm just gonna give myself a handful more wraps. We're kind of building up a little bit of an orange stripe segment on the side of the fly there. And if you've built up a little bit of a stripe on the side, it's time to turn your fly, get that thread right up underneath that foam head, down under the hook shank. Give yourself a good 3 to 5 wraps right there. And then now you're ready to whip finish. Whip finish, snip. All right, now we're gonna trim our legs. Snip off the loops on each leg. Flip that vise inverted so you got the belly of the fly facing up. Collect all those legs. Marry them together so they're all out. And I generally just trim them to whatever the shortest one is. So when you're done, if you're using a different legging material, you want a good inch to an inch and a quarter, inch and a half max. I don't like legs to be too long, because if they're too long, they end up catching more water and spending more time in the water just pulled back like that. Or if they're shorter, they stay a little more rigid and stick out to the side better. Plus, longer legs have more of a tendency to foul underneath that hook bend. Our next step, we're going to trim those eyes. So looking at it from the front, we're going to look at this point here. We're calling the throat of the fly. We're going to start at the front and we're going to angle aimed right at that throat. Bam. And then turn it and reverse it from the other direction. Bam. So it'll look like so. Do the same thing on the other side. Bam and bam. All right. Get those wings out. Okay, that's your fly. Any flies like this that I feel have a strong probability of seeing some hemostat usage in their lifetime, I put a little bit of glue on that knot just to make it a little extra secure. So if you end up grabbing right there with the hemostats, you don't loosen your knot and ruin your fly in the middle of a good fishing day. So there you have it, people. The Cicada Bomber. These things quick, easy to tie, fish extremely well. They're super buoyant. They'll float all day long without needing any bug dope. They got a lot of wiggle to them, very attractive. They got that right cicada profile. If you got the materials on hand, you can make them that Cicada Brood 19 coloration, the black and orange. You can also do these in black and green, and heck, while you're at it, play with some other colors. You never know, right? Hope you enjoyed this. We'll see you downstream.